He just has a very lyrical, wide range of playing, just really going up and grabbing these high octaves and using the full range of the bass neck to say, hey, I'm here, the bass is important, and it's driving the song more than you think. What's up, guys? Welcome back to Lone University. Earlier this summer, we did Mudvayne's Dig. That's the only song I've really heard by the band. And then you guys were adamant for me to check out Soften the Glare, which is Ryan's current jazz fusion instrumental sort of prog project, which I really liked. It showed me what he was capable of when just unleashed with no limitations. With that perspective in mind, I'm going back to LD50, which was released in 2000, the band's debut record. And by your request, you guys asked for Death Blooms. So here we are, my first time listening. Let's check it out. Death Blooms by Mudvayne. That's cool. Dang. Oh yeah. So Dig was like real intense right out of the gate, right? This actually has not too intense vibe, just like a really good metal song. It caught me off guard right in the intro with those harmonics. It sounded like the bass was kind of doubling them, which would be really cool and really something Ryan, I think, would do. It just kind of sounded like a really kind of cool thing there when you take a bass and you put it under a guitar doing it, when the guitar has some distortion and crunch on. It just gives it a really kind of unique sound. And of course, any excuse to bring my Warwick back out. I know Ryan was playing the Warwick Thumbs in those days, so I've got my custom Warwick Thumb. Again, any excuse I could bring this out for video, I'm going to take it. I want to hear that intro part real quick. And let's keep going from there. Yeah, really cool. Sounds like we're... It's kind of down here, F sharp, G. I got to figure out what key they're in, but let's keep going. Okay, C sharp. God. The tone. Relentless. Love how you can just really hear that signature Warwick Thumb sound. I'm pretty sure Ryan was using the stock MEC pickups. I've got EMGs in here, but nonetheless, you can really recognize that it's got a really throaty kind of resonance. It's usually around 200 or 300 hertz, but there's kind of a small scoop in there that kind of gives it this hollow tone that removes any of that muddiness. We're just talking about his tone here. My tone is a little different. I think the pickups on mine warm it up a little bit. I did an EMG comparison video to MECs on my channel where you can kind of hear those differences, but nonetheless, it's great to hear that tone isolated. That is such a signature sound. And if you want to cut through on any kind of heavy sound, Warwick, there's no other bass that does it like this brand. Something about him, they have a mojo, and I love the way he's cutting through. Well, gotta accept my peace, bitch, to a part of me. Just relentless. I love it. That's cool bass stuff. It went up to B, then D, and I kind of had an A major in there. Something like that. Cool key change for this chorus. And again, it has that kind of narrow nasally tone that no matter how heavy a guitar part is, it just really cuts through. That was my favorite thing about recording with the Warwick. Okay, it's Warwick, right? Somebody's going to comment and correct me. It's not Warwick, it's Warwick. I know that. I've always just said Warwick. I've been to Warwick's HQ and they say Warwick. Some of them say Warwick. I'm just going to call it Warwick. Now you got it in my head. Nonetheless, I love the bass moving on here to really cut through and have those weaving bass parts in a genre like this, new metal, really interesting. And I think he set the bar so early on for what bass could do in heavy music. And we're just, like a lot of people like me, are appreciating that today. Cool. Ooh. That's super cool. Wow. That's a cool chord. Kind of like an E major thing there, but he's got it kind of inverted. Really cool chord to stop on. I want to hear that again. And that meter change, let's see if that was a tempo change or they just kind of double timed it. That was just a cool shift in feel. Let's see. Tempo increase to me. Cool. Ooh, there's a really cool shot of him there. And I'm hearing him grab the double stops. You know, I noticed this in the dig video a lot. He would accent with the drums with these double stops, whether it was tritones, which is just a flat fifth. So whether it was just like a kind of thing, or whether it was just a fifth, or whether it was an octave or a fourth. I can hear him putting those little pops in there that just line right up with certain hits. Great orchestration. There was that shot there where he kind of popped something. Let's see if I can catch it. Yeah, epic shot. Yeah. There's the E major. I'm coming. That stuff. That's total Ryan Martinie. Kind of the original tempo now. The chorus is actually pretty beautiful. You know, singer can get really harsh and gritty, but he's got this kind of deftone sort of sound. You know, whoever came first doesn't matter, but it just reminds me of kind of a Chino chorus where it's real breathy. It's just kind of elongated, kind of following the chord progression. And you have the bass just running acrobatic stuff underneath it. Whatever it is. It sounds like it actually goes down to G. Back it up right here and see. Yeah, it goes down to G here. It really is a pretty chorus. I don't know, just really catchy and emotive. So that progression in the bass part is kind of going B, A, G. And then the second time it goes up, then it does the inverted. That kind of progression, actually pretty poppy progression amidst how aggressive the notes are in the chorus and the intro and the verse, a lot of tritones and just chromatic stuff. It's really cool. I didn't expect this from Mudvayne. Again, I'm not really familiar with this band, but it just really opened up to some really pretty lyrical chord progressions. This is really catchy. Down that B string. I hear a tritone in there.
Roiling hate, death grip in my veins. Failing rinse of petals, flowering forth foul nectar. Space between a blink and a tear, death blooms.
Wow. Wow, what an ending. Well, that was something else. It really was. It surprised me how pretty and melodic that chorus was, despite my only exposure being with Dig, which was just a lot of chromatic and just fast chuggy stuff. I didn't know Mudvayne had this side to them. I really didn't. I might have heard a Mudvayne song other than these two over the years, but don't recall. This was really cool, and I loved how forefronted the bass was with those really melodic lines in the chorus. But again, this had all the staples I know to be true of Ryan: the popping, the double stops, the really intuitive placement of accents for intensity. And then when it got melodic, he opened up. That chorus bass line reminded me of what I heard in the Soften the Glare song, March of the Cephalopods. He just has a very lyrical, wide range of playing, just really going up and grabbing these high octaves and using the full range of the bass neck to say, hey, I'm here, the bass is important, and it's driving the song more than you think. I'm reading here that this song was about Chad's grandmother growing older and not being taken care of, and him feeling like nobody cared about her. It's a sad reality that happens a lot. So heavy subject matter for a song like this. And, you know, without paying attention to the lyrics, I guess there were subtitles as I was watching, but I could just hear there was something really deep and emotional. I'm kind of reading this after the fact, but thinking back to that somber nature of those vocals, the way it ended, just kind of unresolved. It really fits the story. It kind of ties it together now. But thank you guys for requesting Death Blooms. Glad I got to bring this guy out. Please like the video and make sure you're subscribed. Cheers. Love you all. And we will see you next time.